The birds' morning songs enliven the grassy meadow in suburban Chicago. The binoculars went up quickly as the two women identified the birds they saw. They don't call themselves bird watchers. Instead, they are citizen scientists, carefully counting the birds they find.
The importance of counting the birds is we can see trends. We can look back on numbers and see declining trends. We can then look at current numbers and see birds either increasing or decreasing based on what we've done or haven't done.
Jenny Vogt volunteers 20 to 30 hours a week in the spring and summer, counting birds, then entering the data on her computer.
The most important reason for entering the data, and I do use this particular website, is so that other scientists, citizen scientists, Audubon, and researchers can access this data.
The National Audubon Society has just completed an analysis of 40 years of bird population data collected by citizen scientists, and the findings were very disturbing. Judy Pollack heads up bird conservation for the Audubon Society's Chicago region.
The declines were staggering in some of them. You know, so some of our most common birds have in the last 40 years declined, some of them 70%, 80%, 90%.
Nationally, the 10 birds with the biggest declines are the northern bobwhite, the evening grosbeak, the northern pintail, the greater scalp, the boreal chickadee, the eastern meadowlark, the common tern, the loggerhead shrike, the field sparrow, and the grasshopper sparrow. In Illinois, Pollack worries the most about grassland birds like the meadowlark and the bobolink.
The bobolink that we've lost 97% in 40 years, I mean, that's just astonishing. You know, the meadowlark shocked me. You know, meadowlark, it's sort of the common bird of the farms, and that we've lost 87% of them in the last 40 years is really, I think, astonishing.
The biggest reason for the steep declines is the loss of the bird's habitat, says Chicago Region Audubon Director Stephen Packard.
These are birds that depend on a quality habitat of some kind, a quality woodland, a quality savanna or shrubland, quality prairie. Those are the ones going the fastest. The grassland birds and the shrubland birds are going the fastest. And those are the communities that change fastest if they aren't taken care of. And if the grasslands are going and the woodlands and the shrublands and the wetlands, what confidence do we have that we are maintaining a habitat that's a fit habitat for ourselves as a species?
Prairies like this one used to cover half of Illinois and 90% of this county. Now there is less than 1% of the land in Illinois that is covered in prairie. And there is not one single high-quality black soil prairie that's big enough for two prairie birds to breed. It's easier to restore that habitat now than to fight battles to save endangered birds later, according to Doug Stotts, who's in charge of the treasured collection of thousands of birds at Chicago's Field Museum.
You know, when birds get really rare and become endangered species, it's very expensive, and there are always big political battles on how do we, you know, what can we do to save that? Is it worth, you know, saving some bird in the face of somebody wanting to put a hotel there or something? But if you start worrying about the birds while they're still common and maintain them as common, you don't get those really strong disagreements over a particular piece of land, and it's much less costly to hold on to common birds and keeping them common than trying to maintain, you know, bald eagle when the population has almost gone to nothing.
In Illinois, over 1,000 volunteers have taken that message to heart and spend many hours on habitat monitoring and restoration. In 1984, this 45-acre field was donated to a nonprofit conservation group, and volunteers have slowly brought back the prairie. Tom Vanderpool, a Citizens for Conservation board member, says it hasn't been easy.
It's very difficult to find the seed that we need to get the X amount of volunteers out to pull these weeds that we're pulling with today. It takes a lot of will, it takes a lot of determination. You're not going to get it done in just a few years. It's going to take years to do.
But the hard work has paid off, Today, prairie flowers, once long gone, sway in the breeze. And amidst the grasses and flowers, the bobolinks and meadowlarks can again be found. In 6 large prairie restorations in the Chicago area, Audubon found that bobolinks and meadowlarks had increased by nearly 450%. It's making this kind of a difference that fuels the passion of the volunteers.
It's a way that I can connect with my God and Mother Earth and feel a part of the earth. We're so detached anymore. We go from our car into our air-conditioned house, into our office, into the mall. Out here, this is where we're real creatures of the earth. It kind of puts us in our place too. And there's nothing more beautiful than hearing these bobolinks singing and a song sparrow over there and looking at all these gorgeous flowers.
On a recent day, Packard and his volunteers harvested the seeds from the porcupine grass on one of the restored prairies.
They are like little spears, you know, and you can throw them a distance.
Within an hour, the seeds were taken to a nearby 100-acre field and spread by hand amongst the existing pasture grass. Restoration began on this site 3 years ago, and Packard is excited to see some of the first results.
It doesn't look like much, maybe, to the average person. It's terribly exciting to us. When you plant these seeds, they only grow about this much the first year, and you could just never find them, a little wisp. Here we have a toddler. This is a young little bluestem plant. And here's another one. And then this guy, this is the royalty of the prairie. This is the great prairie dropseed grass, Sprobolus heterolepis to you. When it's flowering, it has a smell of buttered popcorn. And you can just smell it across the whole prairie.
But it will take years before this prairie matures. While at the same time, more and more grassland is being gobbled up by development. So what is the future for the nation's common birds?
There's plenty to be optimistic about and plenty to be pessimistic about. You know, when you look in the larger landscape, the numbers are just plummeting. When you come to a small place like this, you see that we do know what to do. So, you know, it's a question of will enough people understand how important this is? I mean, it's really not even just about birds, it's about nature. You know, it's going away, you know, and are people gonna really care enough about that and support putting the kind of resources in that we need?
Pollack hopes that the specter of a world without bobolinks or meadowlarks will turn the tide in favor of providing the resources needed to save them. For Chicago Tonight, I'm Elizabeth Brackett.